Folks around, I know you haven't met before. Would you say hi to a bunch of those? We're glad you're here this morning. This morning is a special Sunday in the church calendar year. It's known as Pentecost Sunday, 6 weeks after Easter. And in the Bible, there's a description of how the gift of the Holy Spirit is given in Luke and Acts. So this morning, our international ministries, our pastors, Marcos, Tim, and Mono, and Min, we're going to hear this in different languages, and we're going to respond to. So just follow on the screen.
Jesús dijo a sus discípulos, ahora voy a enviarles lo que ha prometido mi Padre, pero ustedes quédense en la ciudad de Jerusalén hasta que sean revestidos del poder de lo alto. Cuando llegó el día de Pentecostés, todos estaban unidos en el mismo lugar. Jesus said to his disciples, I'm going to send you what my Father has promised. But stay in Jerusalem until you have been clothed with power from on high. When the day of Pentecost came,
they were all together in one place.
Place. 호련히 하늘로부터 급하고 강한 바람 같은 소리가 있어. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of violent wind came from heaven
and filled the whole house where they were sitting.
마치 불의 혀처럼 갈라지는 것들이 그들에게 보여 각 사람 위에 하나씩 임하여 있더니 they saw what seems to be tongues of fire that separate and came to rest on each of them.
All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in tongues. As the Spirit enabled them.
Haba asigae, ambor hovel markarei michotsov svetsav, gese asvats. Im hokis amem marmini vra bidi tapem, utser dghaka, utser aghchiknere bidi markareyanan. This is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my Spirit on all people.
And your sons and their daughters will prophesy.
你们少年人要见异象，老年人要做异梦。 Your young people will see visions.
Your old men will dream dreams.
到那时候，凡求靠主名的就必得救。你们个人要悔改，奉耶稣基督的名受洗。 教你们的罪得赦, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved.
Repent and be baptized,
every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins. 你们就必领受所赐的圣灵，因为这应许是给你们和你们的儿女，并一切在远方的人，就是我们主神所招来的。 And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children, and for all whom the Lord our God will call.
Amen.
Open up.
That song says so much about who God is. It's almost too much to sing in one song. As those phrases come to mind, just take a few moments privately, worship Him. Just repeat those glorious names that we just sang about. Thank Him for that. Father, we thank you for all that you are. We praise your name. Amen. In the Apostle Paul's second letter to Timothy, he writes about this analogy of vessels used for honor. He says, in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also utensils of wood, earthenware. Some are for honorable and noble use. Some are for menial and ignoble use. He goes on to say, so whoever cleanses himself from what is ignoble and unclean, who separates himself from contact with contaminating and corrupting influences, will then himself and herself be a vessel set apart and useful for honorable and noble purposes, consecrated and profitable to the master, fit and ready for any good work. I'd like just to read this unison prayer from the Wesley Covenant service that we do the first Sunday of every year. Let's read this covenant together. I am no longer my own, but yours. Put me to what you will. Reign with whom you will. Put me to doing. Put me to suffering. Let me be employed by you, or laid aside for you, exalted for you, or brought low by you. Let me have all things, and let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to your pleasure and disposal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine, and I am yours. So be it. And the covenant which I have made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Sing this prayer together. I believe you can.
To live a life, Lord, that's worthy of my call. I want to live a life, Lord, that's worthy of my call. And I believe you can change me. And I believe you can use this life. And I believe you can make me an instrument for noble purpose.
Alan knows I love this song. Thank you for including it today. One of my friends, George, wrote this song, and I find myself singing the chorus regularly. But I say to George, if I could change one part of it, I would make the pronouns plural, especially on a day like Pentecost Sunday. So we would sing, we want to live lives, Lord, that are worthy of our call. We want to live lives, Lord, that are worthy of our call, and we believe you can change us. We believe you can use these lives. We believe you can make us, your church, an instrument for noble purposes. Let's sing that together. We want to live lives, Lord, that are worthy of our call. That are worthy of our call. We want to live lives. We want to live lives, Lord, worthy of our call. Worthy of our call. We believe you can change us. We believe you can change us. Use this life. And we believe you can use our lives. And we believe you can make us an instrument for noble purpose. Well, there's lots of things about this area I'm going to miss. A couple of places that I like to go that I will really miss. One is, as I've shared with you, downtown. If I have a chance to kind of waste time downtown, I love to go and walk into the Cathedral of the Angels. If you've been in that beautiful building, you know there are tapestries all along the walls with saints clumped together from all different generations, all facing forward, all facing towards the altar. And a couple of times over these years, I've snuck in there when nobody else really was around and just sat in those pews and thought about not just those saints, but lots and lots of other saints who are part of the cloud of witnesses in my life and in our life. The other place is actually in this building. Downstairs, we have a room we call the archives. It's a great room, especially when you're wanting to hide from people. I go down there when I just need space. So several Sunday mornings, I've hidden down there during Sunday school hour or early in the morning when I need to kind of get my head and heart together. But I love to sit down there and look around at the wall, at old pictures of folks whose names are on buildings, but who are now with the Lord, and leaders of the congregation who came before me. And in a few places, there are old pictures of me when I was much younger and cuter, a lot thinner in particular. But on days like Pentecost Sunday, and especially that it falls this weekend, on Memorial Day weekend, we certainly give God thanks for all of those folks who, through their own self-giving and sacrifice, have made moments like this, moments where we can worship in freedom possible. Memorial Day weekend, we are reminded that our lives are really dependent upon a lot of other people and on the goodness and graciousness of a lot of folks. But on Pentecost Sunday, we are reminded that our lives are dependent upon a lot of other folks. We've been put together in this body, and the ear needs the eye, and the hand needs the foot, and we just need each other. And we need not only we who are present, but we need those who have come before us, who have given to us an amazing legacy of grace and faithfulness. So this morning, I couldn't help but think about Hebrews 11, that by faith chapter. By faith, Abraham. By faith, Isaac. By faith, Jacob and Joseph, and by faith, saint after saint after saint has come. But the writer of Hebrews says this in verse 39 of chapter 11. All these people didn't receive what was promised, though they were given approval for their faith. For God provided something better for us, so they wouldn't be made perfect or complete without us. So then let's also run the race that is laid out in front of us. Since we have such a great cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let's throw off any extra baggage, get rid of the sin that trips us up, and fix our eyes on Jesus, faith's pioneer and perfecter. For he endured the cross, ignoring its shame, and for the sake of the joy that was laid out in front of him, He sat down at the right side of God's throne, where there he intercedes for us. This morning as we go to prayer, we go as those who have been given a race that is set before us, a race in which we have received the baton from those who've gone before us, and now we race and run in ways to hand that on to others. And this morning, I know that some of you are tired, struggling. But as I've said to you before, this race is not one where one person wins. This is a race where if we don't all finish, then we all lose. It's a race we run together. And so we'd love to open these altars and invite you this morning. If you need a place to lean and someone to lean on, these altars are for you. And I didn't invite even brothers and sisters to come and gather around some of those who will come. Be the presence of God's grace in their lives today. Let's sing together as we go to prayer. Father, we love you today. We thank you today for your presence in our lives, and we thank you especially on this weekend for those that you've placed in our lives, the great cloud of witnesses that have gone before us. We thank you for those who've sacrificed and given for the sake of freedom, for the sake of peace. On this Pentecost Sunday, we thank you for those who've walked journeys of faith before us. I especially thank you today for a couple of grandfathers and grandmothers who loved you deeply, who set a trajectory of faithfulness for our family, who are with you in glory. We thank you today for Roger Dillon. We pray, God, you'd be with their family. We give you thanks for James DeBoard. 101 years of serving you faithfully. And But we thank you that 101 isn't even enough, that you have given to him today the gift of eternal life. We continue to pray for Richard Alvarado and Evelyn Sanner and Sixta and Ruth. Surround them with your care. Father, we pray for those numbers of folks who are battling cancer. In particular, we pray for Daryl, who's here this morning, and that you would touch him. But be with Jamie and John and Rosemary and so many others. We pray for Boone this morning. He is struggling, Lord. We pray, God, that you would heal and bring blessing to him. Be with Jean and Bodie and Lilas and Margie and Barbara. Give strength to Jerry today, we pray, and Randy. And Don Grimm and Don Kaiser, touch their bodies. Pray your grace upon Ruth Ann in her upcoming surgery. Give her strength. Father, I pray for those who come forward this morning. You know where we are, what we need. Our circumstances change, but your love and favor and grace and goodness never changes. So we thank you that we can lean upon who you are. Make yourself known in our circumstances. You've invited us here today. You are the audience, and so receive our praises that we've given today from glad and joyful hearts. But we also invite you to speak. And so speak to us today through your word. Help us to have ears to hear. And on this day in particular, we pray that you would make us your people, a people known in the world as your disciples. Teach us to pray today as you taught disciples to pray. Let's pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thanks, choir. Thanks, orchestra. It is good to see you this morning. I always love holiday weekends. We get to find out who the true Christians are, and congratulations, you're in that bunch. No, it's great to see you this morning. Our youth are down at Point Loma for Elevate, and so all of our youth ministers are gone today. Scott Anderson's on vacation, but you are here, and it is good to be together in the house of the Lord. The ushers are coming by with notebooks for each of the rows. We'd love to know that you're with us this morning, especially if you're a guest. Welcome. Just a quick reminder that next Sunday, we will be all together. It won't change your habits very much. We'll be here together at 10:30, but the 8 o'clock service will be here as well. Valley Center will be here. Our other congregations are invited to come and take part. We will have one big service at 10:30 next week. And because of the nature of next week, we have some folks who are joining the church, but I'd like to pull a fast one on you. We're going to welcome everybody next week who is joining the church. In fact, we're going to do a lot of things next Sunday. We're going to dedicate babies. We're going to welcome people into the church. If you'd like to get married, we can pull that off probably in the middle somewhere. We'll fill up the baptismal if we need to. We'll just get everything taken care of this one last week before we go. No, that's great. Thanks for your love and prayers for us, and it is just good to be part of the body of Christ today. Father, thanks for the way that you take care of our needs, the way you love us and supply our needs. And so we give back to you just out of your generosity. So bless these gifts today. Multiply them for the purposes of your kingdom, for we pray in your son's name. Amen. Thank you. Wow, wow. I meant to say earlier two things. Just thanks for all your kindness. Deb wanted me to thank all the ladies, especially for the big party last night, and you even wrote a song about her and everything. Wow, you know, I haven't gotten a song yet. I'm just saying, but that's great. It's beautiful. But just thanks for all your notes and kindness over these last couple of weeks and continued prayers. It's always good to see friends. I meant to welcome the Songers are with us today. Rob is the district superintendent in the district right above us at Central Cal, and more importantly, just good friends. And so Songers, good to have you with us today. If you have a Bible, turn with me this morning to the book of Exodus, to the 20th chapter, Exodus chapter 20. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You must have no other gods before me. Do not make an idol for yourself, no form whatsoever of anything in the sky above or on the earth below or in the waters under the earth. Do not bow down to them or worship them, because I, the Lord your God, am a passionate God. I punish children for their parents' sins, even to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me. But I'm loyal and gracious to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. Do not use the Lord your God's name as if it were of no significance. The Lord won't forgive anyone who uses his name that way. Remember the Sabbath day and treat it as holy. 6 days you may work and do all your tasks, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. Do not do any work on it. Not you, your sons or daughters, your male or female servants, your animals, or the immigrant who is living with you, because the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and everything that is in them in 6 days, but rested on the seventh day. That is why the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother so that your life will be long on the fertile land that the Lord your God is giving you. Do not kill. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not testify falsely against your neighbor. And do not desire your neighbor's house. Do not desire and try to take your neighbor's wife, male or female servant, ox, donkey, or anything else that belongs to your neighbor. So we've been thinking about Exodus, about God's deliverance of the people out of bondage. And we mentioned, as we thought about the plagues, that I think it's intentional that we have 10 plagues in the story, and then when God gets the people out of Egypt, we get 10 commandments on the mount. That in a sense, God is bringing the people, as I like to say so often, not just getting Israel out of Egypt, but getting Egypt out of them. That Egypt, the embodiment of Pharaoh in Egypt, is this kind of life that ultimately we're drawn into, we're lured into, but the more we're lured into that life, the more destruction happens. So the plagues are kind of 10 ways in which God says that life messes everything up. It's not just that that life irritates me, but that life brings destruction to others. It enslaves people like the Israelites. And even though Pharaoh thinks it works for him, it doesn't. It brings destruction even to him. It's a messy, ugly, destructive form of life. So I'm bringing you out of that. But now as I bring you out of that, I'm going to teach you a new life. And these 10 commands will in so many ways embody the kind of life that I have for you. Certainly, it's not the sum of it. The 10 commandments are certainly important, but I would encourage you to read the next few chapters in Exodus, if you have time today or tomorrow this week, to think about some of the richness and fullness of the law. And if you have more time, just keep right on going into Deuteronomy and Leviticus and think about the richness and fullness and all the textures of the law. But in so many ways, these 10 commands embody what I think is the purpose of the law. So I want to think about them with you this morning. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. Whatever else this relationship is that God has redeemed us out of and brought us into, this relationship is an exclusive relationship. it's fascinating the ways I've talked about this with you before. It's fascinating the ways that I think the living out of our sexual covenants reflects our understanding of this with God. I heard a paper years ago that has just stuck with me that the scholar argued that when the people believed in many gods, their sexual covenants were just all over the place. And as they moved from polytheism, it shouldn't surprise us that they lived out their lives then in polygamy as they were polytheists. And as they moved to what's called henotheism, where there's a god above all the other gods, they still practiced polygamy, but there was a kind of wife over the other wives. But the more they came to understand that there is no other god but Yahweh, and he invites us in this exclusive relationship, it shouldn't be surprising that people came to understand their own living out of their relationships in the uniqueness of monogamous covenant with another. And so that God says, listen, this is a monogamous covenant between you and me. You cannot have other gods. They are not welcomed at our table. You can have no other gods. The temptation, by the way, for Israel was never to abandon the worship of Yahweh. It was always to couple the worship of Yahweh with the worship of other gods. We'll come back to this next week. I'm going to finish with the golden calf text, where Aaron puts all the gold into the pots and a golden calf pops out, according to him. Whenever you see the Baals, the Baals, the gods in the Old Testament, the gods are almost always fertility gods. They're gods that make sure we have lots of kids, because in those days, kids made us money, and that make sure that our crops grow. Because here's the temptation for the people. Yahweh is trying to teach us a different kind of life where we get daily bread. Remember last week, you are what you eat. And God is breaking them of that and giving them daily bread, teaching them a different kind of way of living. But what if we could have that life, but we could have the other life too? And so this morning, it's important for us as we think about our relationship with God. The temptation for the Israelites is no different than our temptation. For most of you in this room, the temptation will not be to abandon worship of God. The temptation for all of us will be to mix the worship of our God with all of the other idols of our culture. And Jesus says, listen, you can't do that. You can't worship both God and mammon. You can't worship both God and money. You can't worship both God and any other kind of desire, because inevitably you will love the one and hate the other. You'll be devoted to one and despise the other. There's no way to do that. It starts with that exclusive relationship with God. But you can't make any graven images of me and spend a lot of time here, but certainly that's because God, who he is, transcends anything we could ever make to say, this is what God looks like. For God is so much bigger than anything we could ever imagine. But I'm convinced that the primary reason Israel is not allowed to make images of God is because God is making images of himself. In Genesis 1, verse 27, the creation narrative tells us this, and then God made humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. We do not make images of our God because he is forming his image in us. He is trying to form us and make us to be reflections of his character and nature in the world, which is why command number 3 is so important. So we cannot use his name inappropriately. I've said this to you lots, but growing up, I thought that was a command about cussing. And you just can't hit a bad golf shot and use God's name somewhere in that. But as I've tried to teach you, every time you read the Old Testament, you see the word Lord capitalized, you know that's that sacred name God gave to Moses at the burning bush. That name that gets translated either Jehovah or Yahweh. But for good Jewish folks, you can't say that name even in sacred moments because it's so sacred. So you'd never stub your toe and do the Yahweh, 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 Yahweh. I mean, you just don't do that, right? You can't do that. So the command is not really about cussing. It's about this. It's that whatever the world knows about God, and in our case, whatever the world knows about Christ, we are a people who have placed on our lives the label Christian. And because of that, whatever the world knows about Jesus, whatever the world knows about God, they know because of his people. And by the way, that hasn't always been good. That's why in the notes I give you this morning, one of my favorite texts I think I've preached on about 7 times over the last 9 years, Ezekiel 36. where God says to Israel, listen, I'm going to have to sanctify you. I'm going to make you holy, but not for your sake, O house of Israel, but for my sake, for the sake of my name that you have profaned among the nations to which you came. My paraphrase of Ezekiel 36 is this: the people in the world think I am a lousy God because you are a really lousy people. So I am going to have to make you a holy people, because the problem, and please, I think God takes this really, really seriously. Please don't play with God's name. If you don't want to be Christian, don't claim to be. Not only do you do the church no favors, you do God no favors. Because the world thinks that God is this either, in our cases, either this horrible, ugly, legalistic tyrant, because that's the way you reflect him in the world, or this mushy, sentimental, permissive deity that just kind of gives us lollipops when we need them, because that's the way we tend to reflect him in the world. Please, if you care about who you are in relationship to God and you are willing to bear his name in the world, God says, please, for my sake, bear it rightly. Do not misuse this name in the world. Command 4, honor the Sabbath and keep it holy. As you walk in this relationship with me, we're going to have practices that remind you of who you are. Because, and I hope you've picked this up over the last 9 years, I am absolutely convinced we are what we practice to become. We are what we habit ourselves to become. And so the Sabbath was primarily about, and it's rich and full and deserves about 10 sermons on its own. Certainly it's about the limitation of who we are, recognizing our connectedness to the earth, giving the earth a break, giving the world that we are dependent upon a time to renew and relax. It's about telling us that we are more than what we do for a job. We are more than work. There's so much richness to the Sabbath, but it also says this: you are going to be a people unlike everybody else. You have a particular practice, and people are going to look at you and say, oh, there go those Sabbath people again. You see, I kind of have a love-hate relationship with the kind of Christian tradition that we're a part of. So stay awake, because don't fall asleep with that being the last sentence that I said. So I've shared with you before, I love especially down at the farmer's market at the Grove. There's this little candy shop called Little John's that makes the best toffee in the universe. So we had some free time last night, so we went down to the Grove last night to get toffee one more time. We may have to go one more time. But we went down there to get toffee and hang around. But every time we go to the Grove, if you've ever been there in Beverly Hills, especially if you go there on a Friday night or a Saturday evening, the same thing happens. You drive through, and there in Beverly Hills are all these synagogues. And there are all these Orthodox Jews walking to temple, long beards, curls, big black hats, all dressed, either walking to synagogue or last night walking home from synagogue. And they're walking because it's Sabbath. You can't drive on Sabbath. You have to walk everywhere. And every time we go there, we have the same conversation. It's this conversation that says, how do you do that? How, in maybe the most secular, opulent piece of property in the world, do you keep this strange, unique, weird way of life alive? You do it because you grow beards, you have curls, you have hats, and you walk to synagogue. And I'm sure that as we have conversations about them, every once in a while as a family, they have conversations like, Dad, do we have to go to synagogue again? Oy vey. Right? Seriously. I have Orthodox Jew envy, but not just because I can't grow a good beard. But I have envy because one of the greatest things about being, you know, if you would call our kind of place within the Christian tradition, kind of evangelical Christianity, the great thing about evangelical Christianity is you could come however you wanted to come today. And some of you took that very seriously. Came how you were, you are, and we love that. We're happy you're here as you are. We sang songs that have kind of Christian-y words to them, but they kind of sound like songs you might sing other places too. I mean, the best thing about being evangelical is you can totally blend in. The worst thing about being evangelical is you can totally blend in. So I wonder sometimes, what are the practices my children will think of as the practices that defined us as a family, especially as a Christian family? And I want to be careful here. I want to be sensitive because I know that we are in a very difficult culture that is very fast and very busy, and there are lots of things that pull on our lives. But I have to say, as somebody who grew up in the church, I am so thankful that, and I wasn't always thankful, but I'm thankful now at 49. I wasn't always thankful at 14, but at 49, I'm thankful that Sunday really was never an option for us. For us as a family, it was never, do you think we should go today? It was like, do we have to go early today and set up? But that there was a kind of regular practice to worship for us. Because that, honestly, that's what made us who we are as a family. That's just what we did. And I don't know what that's going to be for you, but I want to say out of that command, if regular participation in worship is not a practice you can sustain as a person or as a family, as a Christian, you had better answer this question. What are going to be the practices that sustain you as a person of faith? Because you can't do it apart from those practices. You just can't. I'm going to be really careful here, and I'm going to be really fast, but I'll share with you just one of my disappointments as pastor. And it's just a little one. But I remember years ago, Deb and I were visiting a church. We had just gotten married, and we were here on vacation down in the south part of town. And we visited a couple of big churches, and one that if I named you would know. But we were visiting there, and we were walking. We had to walk a long ways to get to the sanctuary, and we were crossing the street. And I said to Deb as we were across the street, look at all these people. And I said, look at all of them. They all have Bibles and notebooks in their hands. I mean, look at them. Headed to church like this. And I said to her, someday, I hope that happens for us. Right? So we're going to try it somewhere else. So now I know that this is an electronic age, and I can say to you, turn in your iPhone, you know. And I know all of that has changed the way that we are, but I just want to encourage you. One of my desires was for you to become great students of God's word, to come to church with expectation that you would hear from God today. And here's something you might want to write down. That you would be shaped in that kind of way. Are you with me? I mean, it's not like we use different books every week and it gets very confusing. It's the same book. And if you don't have one, you are welcome to steal the one in front of you. We don't even call it stealing. Just take it, right? But that fourth command says, listen, this is an exclusive relationship with me. Don't make graven images. I'm making my image in you, and I am forming you, and you bear my name, so bear it rightly. But you're going to have to learn to do that because you're going to have all these other pressures. So we should have a regular practice that allows you to be formed as that people. Are you with me? Honor your father and mother. Now, I learned that as obey your father and mother. I think it's because my parents taught me the Ten Commandments. It's not a bad idea to obey your parents. But the code really is about honoring them. It's about that in ancient cultures, when people got too old to contribute to the economy, in agrarian settings where you needed people to plant and harvest and take, you know, care, you need people with good backs. When they wore out and all they did was eat and not grow, take and not give. There are cultures where you take your parents out to an ice floe and say, thanks, mom and dad, you know, enjoy the polar bears. I mean, you just did that, right? You just pushed them. And God says, no, listen, different culture. You are going to be a people who recognize you are deeply dependent on everything that's come before you, and you are going to honor, you will be a culture of honor. I just want to say the scripture extends that as it goes forward beyond father and mother to people. I mean, this is us, right? Nazarenes, people nobody thought anything good could come from them. This gets extended so that the church will be that people who will always be a culture of honor for people that you wonder, what are we going to get out of this? And the answer is, I don't know. Maybe nothing, but that's not the point. The point is to be a people who learn to honor and love the way that God has learned to love and honor us. That's why, just real quickly, the thing, so many things I'm proud of this congregation, but at the top of the list is the ministry to folks with special needs. To be a church that says, we will honor and love and embrace you, include you in all of the challenges of who you are. We have space for you. You add to us as a body. The ear needs the eye, the hand needs the foot, but as Paul says, there are even parts that sometimes the world overlooks that the body of Christ treats with even greater honor, because that's who we are as a people. That's why there will always be a seat in the front row for the poor in the Church of the Nazarene. Why? Because we never calculate what you're going to bring to us or not bring to us. Because we're a people of honor. And we're a people who are connected to God, and therefore you can't love God and you can't and not love your neighbor. So you can't kill, you can't commit adultery, you can't steal, you can't bear false witness against your neighbor. This relationship with God immediately connects us with each other. And then finally, you can't covet. I'm gonna form a people who don't just do the right things, but have the right heart. Who learn to live with contentment, who don't get into that easy trap that the world gets us into, where we're always trying to keep up with the Joneses. And we're constantly lured into what we can have that we don't have now, and so we constantly live lives of discontentment rather than lives of contentment and gratitude. We live lives of discontentment and grumbling. Do you see that pattern? Connection with God, connection with each other, practices that we're going to live out and embody. Now here's the heart of it all, and I'm going to land this thing. The longer I'm in this, and the more that I think I understand what God is trying to do, the more I'm convinced that God is not just in the business of redeeming persons, although he certainly wants to do that, but that God is in the business of forming a people. That God takes Israel up on this mountain and says, listen, I am going to form you to be a particular kind of people, a people that are a mystery to the world, a people who embody the things that are true and right and consistent with the way I've created. And as you do that, you will be a light to the nations. And so that we shouldn't be surprised when we get to Matthew that Jesus takes his people up onto a mount and preaches them a sermon. That sounds like this. You've heard it said this, but I tell you this. And as you learn that life, Jesus says, you, and I love in Matthew, I wish we could change it. I've said this to you before. I wish we could change it to y'all. Because the pronoun there is plural. It's not you. I mean, you are the salt of the earth. I mean, you are. But really, Jesus wants to say, all y'all. Y'all, all y'all are the light of the world. All y'all are the salt of the earth. And you don't put a community together who becomes the light to the world and then hide it under a bushel basket. You build that community of righteousness and faithfulness and goodness and beauty and gentleness and kindness. You build that community and you put it on a lampstand so the whole world can see it and say, how did those people get that way? And then those things will point them to your Father who is in heaven. And on this day, we celebrate that God didn't just say, so do it, all right? Grit your teeth and do it. Come on. Holiness on three. One, two, three. Holiness, go. Yeah. But that he gave us his spirit to empower us to be what he has called us to be. And out of that, the mystery becomes that it's not just a localized people, but this people, as we've celebrated today, from every tribe and nation and language come together to form this new people who are not a country, but redefine even what being part of a country even means. They're not monocultural. They don't even speak all the same language. But somehow, by the mystery of God's grace and spirit, he is forming a people across boundaries and borders and denominations to be a reflection of who he is in the world, a people called the church. And can I say, since I'm on this, and I'm fire me if you want, but here's the thing. I'm so convinced of this that I even think God's primary method of evangelism in the world is the church. I grew up thinking the church was a people who had a message. And at some level, we do. But the longer I'm in this, the more I'm convinced we are a people who are the message and not just have the message. So that so much of our evangelism should be when people encounter this thing called the church and all of our places where God sends us, that they say, there is something about those people, I don't know what it is, but it's truthful and beautiful and right, and I want in. And you can then say, well, come on. Watch the water on your way through. You got to go through that. But get through, you know, right? Leave that old stuff behind. Come on, we'll take you. That today we celebrate that God is forming this amazing people that he calls his church, his body in the world. People covenanted with him. People who bear his name rightly, who are formed in his image, who participate in practices that shape us to be that, who honor those who sometimes get overlooked, and a people who allow that relationship with God to be translated into our relationship with each other, and we're learning this kind of groovy, contented life with God. Isn't that great? So today, on Pentecost Sunday, I want to tell you how thankful I am for the church. I'm thankful for this church. But I'm thankful for this church, and I'll use a small c here. This is a small c church. I'm thankful for the way that the small c church fits within the large c church. As we'll do next week, when I was little, my parents brought me to a small c church in Detroit, Michigan, of all places. And in that moment, the large C church made a commitment. My parents came and said, we do not know what to do with this thing that God has given to us. All arms and legs. We don't know what to do with them. So help us. And through those small C church folks, the big C church made a commitment to say, we will love and care and pray. I'm going to cry, okay? I am who I am largely today because the Big C Church and a whole lot of small C church places, Detroit, Kansas City, Gainesville, Golden, Colorado, Phoenix, Oklahoma City, Dallas, Seattle, Nampa, Idaho, Pasadena, California. The Big C Church and lots of small C church places loved and cared and prayed, gave space for failure, grace, where sin abounded, grace abounded more. Twenty-five years ago, Deb and I stood in front of a small C church, and the big C church said, we think God is in on this, and we'll bless you and pray God's blessing on it. And with four little ones that we had no idea what to do with, through a small C church, the big C church said, we'll take care of them too, and we'll even try to educate them and bless them, pray for them. Through a lot of little C churches, the big C church has given me a place to serve and to explore what God wants to do through me and do through you, do through us. And someday, I hope a long time from now, someday, my body's going to lay in front of a small C church. And the Big C Church is going to say, praise God from whom all blessings flow. Thanks for the way that you used him. And offer that life back to the God from whom that life came. You see, my concern for you, for us, for all of us, especially in this kind of culture, and I say this a lot, but I want you to tattoo it somewhere on your body. The church is not just some place that we go to get help. It is, I hope that you get help when you come to these small seat places called church. But the church is not just something and some place that we go. The church is something that we are. Something that we are. Across denominational lines, cultural lines, language lines, it is something that he is inviting us into, called his body. Connected to him, living a life the world cannot understand in its own terms, a life only possible by the empowering of the Holy Spirit in the lives of believers who love each other even though they're so different from each other. Reflecting his beauty, bearing his name rightly in the world. It's not enough to get us out of Egypt. He has got to get Egypt out of us and form us to be his people. There's an old hymn that goes like this. I think you'll know some of the words. I think they'll help me. The church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died. Listen to these words. Elect from every nation, yet one o'er all the earth. Her charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth. One holy name she blesses, partakes one holy food. To one hope she presses, with every grace endued. The last verse of this great hymn says this: yet she on earth hath union with God, the three in one, and mystic sweet communion with those whose race is one. O happy ones and holy, Lord, give us grace that we, like them, the meek and lowly on high, may dwell with thee. Yet she on earth hath union with God the three in one, and blessed sweet communion with those whose race is one. O happy ones and holy, Lord, give us grace that we, like them the meek and lowly, on high may dwell with thee. Father, I thank you today for the body of Christ. We recognize today that what you are forming is so mysterious and challenging. How you make a group of commuters with busy schedules from different generations and different cultures, How you form us to be your people is a mystery that only your Spirit can do. And so, Father, I pray for Pasadena first, 110 years of amazing history. I pray that this place would not just be a big, beautiful building where people go to church. But I would pray that building or no building, campus or no campus, history or no history, that you would form Pasadena first, not into a place to go, but into something that we are. May we be the church together. Forgive us our sins. Teach us how to bear your name rightly in this city and in the world. I thank you that the Big C Church is bigger than this small C building and this campus. So I thank you for friends and brothers and sisters like Pastor Albert over in Monrovia and my friend Kerwin up in Northwest Pasadena, and for Pastor Jean today. I know she has brought the word on this Pentecost Sunday. Pray for my friend Greg down at Lake Avenue and our brothers and sisters in Sierra Madre. As our group of pastors likes to say, we are one church in Pasadena. We just meet in a bunch of different places. So teach us how to live that. And I thank you today for a global church. We have brothers and sisters who have sung and worshiped and danced before you today and preached and proclaimed and invited people to join this living body called your church all around the world today. So make us more than just an American church. Make us a global church. Reflect who you are to the world. So on this Pentecost Sunday, help your old folks have visions and your young folk dream dreams. And may all who call on your name today, may they find a new kind of life. We pray that you'd get us out of Egypt. But we pray by your Spirit that you'd get Egypt out of us today. Make us your church. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's stand together.
Sprinkle rises, we wait upon. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait.
Listen well this morning. God has drawn us together to this place because we are His church. He has drawn us close to His heart. He has breathed us in. He has held us close to Himself. And now He's going to breathe us out. And we will be no less His church scattered around this community for the next several days as we are gathered here this morning. And so now, may the God of peace, may He sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept sound and blameless until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And He who called us to be His church, He is faithful and He will finish His work in us. And all God's people said, amen. 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 Go in His peace.